A reading from Acts. Luke writes, "In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, and giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Word of God, word of life.
Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the 11 and those with them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised, so stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." And then Jesus led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple, blessing God. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. In my home church growing up, there was always one major anxiety on our minds. I grew up in a small town, and we were a small country church, and the roof always leaked, and we never had the money to fix it. And as I went from church to church going through seminary, I found this was often an anxiety of different congregations, that the roof would leak and there would not be any funds to replace it. That's not true here at St. Stephen. That's a result of good stewardship and good leadership that cares for this building. But I know of one church in the world that never has to worry about this problem of the roof leaking. There is a church on the Mount of Olives across the hill from Jerusalem, and it is the Church of the Ascension, and it's built on the site that we celebrate this weekend, the site of Jesus' ascension. And the reason they don't have to worry about the roof leaking is pretty simple. They have no roof. The Church of the Ascension is built with nothing above it. It's only walls and an altar. And it's built that way to remember the act of what Jesus did there. It's also built to remember that God, of course, is bigger than our buildings, that God is expansive, reaching up into the heavens, just as Jesus did at the ascension. So this weekend, we gather, and metaphorically, we blow the roof off of this building. We remember God's bigness. We remember Jesus' ascension into heaven. And we give thanks for that act. And as we hear the stories, both from Acts and from the book of Luke, these stories of Jesus ascending into heaven, there is one theme that stretches across both stories. And it's a word. It's a word that Jesus invites his disciples to seize and grab hold of. And it's a little bit of a funny word, because I don't think it's the word that we think of primarily when we wonder about what is our job as disciples of Christ. And that word, and you hear it both in Luke and in Acts, is to be a witness. Jesus says to them in both stories, "You will be my witnesses, first in Jerusalem, and then to other countries, and all the way across the ends of the earth." And that's a funny word, that word witness, because Jesus does not ask us to be moralists. Jesus does not ask us to be philosophers. Jesus doesn't ask us to be speculators. He asks us to be a witness to what God has done through him on earth. And its most primary level, that word witness, we all understand it has a pretty basic set of following for us to do. If we're going to be a witness, it's a pretty basic job. We should tell the truth, tell the whole truth, and so help us God as we go about telling that truth in the world. And it's a funny command, because often as disciples of Christ, there are many things that we believe we are meant to do. Jesus says today to focus on being a witness, to tell the truth of the story of God. And we aren't always the most gifted at focusing in on that identity as being disciples, to be witnesses, to tell the truth. Right now, I'm preparing to take another one of my intensive classes as I continue my seminary education. Just a few weeks, I'll be going back to Columbus, and I'm taking a class on educational ministries. In order to take that class, we always read a few books before we descend on Columbus, before all the interns from across the country gather. And one of the books that we're reading in advance of that class is a book that's about how we educate our youth in the church. And the focus of that book is that it describes that right now in the church, most youth finish their time going through ministry, and if they're asked, what's the main idea, what's the main point of being a follower of Jesus, the most common phrase is that they say, well, it's important to be nice. It's important to be nice. And I don't want anyone to leave this place and think that's not true. Jesus had some pretty strong things to say about loving God and loving neighbor. And as a result of that, we are nice. We are kind to each other. But what that book laments, and it goes right with our witness message for today, is that being a disciple of Christ, yes, it is a message to be kind, to be nice, to love our neighbors. But we hear Jesus today say it is also a charge to be a witness, to tell the story of God. It's a charge that being a member of a church, being a follower of Jesus, it's a little bit more than just asking people how to behave. It's a little bit more than indoctrinating people with a certain certainty of belief. Being a witness means to go out and tell the story of God. To tell the story of this Jesus who was born in humble circumstances. To tell the story of Jesus who rose up and spoke truth to power. To tell the story, to tell the truth about this Son of God who had such a powerful proclamation that thousands left their homes, left their jobs, and they followed him around Galilee and they leaned in close in the days before microphones to hear his proclamation. To be a witness means to tell the story of this Jesus who scandalously ate with all those who he wasn't supposed to be close to, tax collectors and sinners and all those who had been marked as impure, and Jesus sat with them and ate with them. To be a witness is to tell the story of these authorities who feared his power so much that they rose up against him, that they killed him in the most humiliating way. And primarily, this post-resurrection Jesus wants his disciples and wants us to also witness to what happens next. To witness who a God, this God whose love was so big, that God's love was stronger than a tomb, that God breaks out of that grave and comes out and loves the world even more. Perhaps this is the most important thing we can witness to as disciples. That this God, this Jesus who broke out of the grave, when he overcame death, he did not seek out those who killed him and acted with vengeance. He did not seek out those who abandoned him and gave them shame. He did not scold those who had denied him. This Jesus, this God, comes forth from the grave and says to all those who followed him, "Peace be with you. God loves you. God promises you eternal life." And go out and tell that story. Go tell about a God who loves that big, a God who never seeks vengeance, who never seeks to increase shame, but tells his followers to tell the story of how God loves, that that is the primary marker of who God is, that God is a God of love, and we are invited to tell the world that story. When I hear this reading from Acts and the disciples are left standing there after Jesus ascends into heaven, my favorite part of the reading is that they're all sitting there and they're just looking up. And they're just sort of standing around. It reminds me, I grew up on a farm with a couple dogs who had a frequent habit of chasing a possum or a squirrel up a tree. Whenever they would do that, they would sit under that tree and they would just look up. They would look up for 6 hours, for 12 hours, for 24 hours. They would sit there and just look at whatever creature was in the tree. And in the meantime, of course, maybe there'd be four or five squirrels or possums or raccoons that would walk right by them, and they would have no idea. They would have such tunnel vision that they would forget their immediate surroundings. And I think about those disciples sitting there where the ascension happened, just looking up, not doing anything, wondering about where Jesus is. And then these angels appear, and they give a pretty frank, simple message. They say to the disciples, they say to us, "What are you doing, just looking up? There's work to be done. There's the joy of spreading the gospel. Go out from this place, tell the story, witness to who God is." And for all of us who perhaps at times can have tunnel vision of what it means to be a disciple, that maybe we think it's all about behavior, or all about morals, or all about indoctrinating people, we hear from those angels and from Jesus tonight that instead of having that tunnel vision of just focusing on one thing, simply go out from that place. Praise God. Be a witness. Tell the truth. Tell about a God who loves us unconditionally, relentlessly, radically, every day, every moment. Tell that truth. Be a witness. So help us, God. Amen.